I would say almost all epistemologists agree, except for the most radical skeptics, that we have to have some epistemic circularity, because we can't reason to the idea that our brains are reliable without using our brains, for example, right?
Liz, every time you answer, you use your own reasoning, but you haven't given any justification for why your reasoning is valid in the first place. How do you know your reasoning is valid? Through your reasoning? Have you not presupposed your reasoning when responding?
Yeah, I think this is actually a cool question, because it gets into circularity. Circularity is a huge topic in epistemology. And I do want to plug another YouTube channel. It's called The Analytic Christian. Andrew Moon has several interviews on that channel about circularity, and he's going to go into a lot more detail than I'm able to here. So if you're interested in this, you should go check that out. But the basic idea is that, to an extent, some level of circularity is unavoidable. You have to start reasoning somewhere. You have to trust your brain and your reasoning processes to make progress. So what I want to try to do is distinguish between different kinds of circularity, some of which I think are fine and some of which are not good. So this is one distinction that Andrew makes, is between logical circularity and epistemic circularity. So logical circularity would be like this. You're like, well, why do you believe in God? Give me a reason to believe in God. And I say, well, look, God exists, and God wrote the Bible, and the Bible says that God exists. So God exists. There's an argument for you. So this is actually a valid argument, in the sense that if the premises are true, the conclusion has to be true. But the premises, so it's kind of funny. It's like, you can't say it's invalid, right? But the premises don't give us an additional reason or additional support for the conclusion, because one of the premises is the conclusion. So in this sense, this argument is a logically circular argument, and it's not going to be an argument that is going to be convincing for someone or give us a reason to believe the conclusion. So in that sense, it's problematic, right? Okay, so there's logical circularity, then there's what's called epistemic circularity. Epistemic circularity is about the reliability of some kind of reasoning process. So here is an example. I remembered X correctly 2 days ago. I remembered Y correctly last week. I remembered Z correctly last month. So because I have all these cases of correct memories, my memory is generally reliable. But I'm actually using my memory in order to give an argument that my memory is reliable. So I'm using that same process in order to argue that this process is reliable. So it's circular. Notice here, it's not just any proposition is in the conclusion. The conclusion is about the reliability of some reasoning process. That's why it's epistemic circularity, not just logical. And Mike Bergman has a really famous paper on epistemic circularity. It actually won a big prize. So really important, really famous paper. And he says there's two kinds of epistemic circularity. There's malignant epistemic circularity, which takes away our justification. And so he gives this case that's kind of funny. You go up to a car salesman and you say, are you reliable? Can I trust you? And the car salesman's like, yes, definitely. You can absolutely trust me. I will never lie to you about cars. I'm super reliable. And then they're like, oh, okay. Well, if he says he's reliable, then I guess I can trust him, you know? So obviously it's like this circular reasoning. And Bergman says, there's something fishy about this, right? We shouldn't go up to car salesmen and ask if they're reliable. And then if they say yes, believe them. Right. It seems like there's other cases of circularity that are what Bergman calls benign circularity. These are cases of epistemic circularity that don't take away justification. So the memory case would be one of these. Or generally just thinking that your brain or your mind is reliable when you're undergoing some kind of process of reasoning. And so basically what Bergman says is, if you have some kind of independent reason to doubt a process. So in the car salesman case, you have kind of an independent reason to be suspicious of this car salesman, right? Then we should think that this epistemic circularity takes away justification. But if you don't have an independent reason to be suspicious of this reliability of the process in question, then the circularity is benign. So there, again, check out Andrew's video, or if you're really nerding out on this, go check out Bergman's paper on epistemic circularity. But the idea is that almost all epistemologists agree, except for the most radical skeptics, that we have to have some epistemic circularity, because we can't reason to the idea that our brains are reliable without using our brains, for example, right? So this is a point that Plantinga makes. God actually has to use God's own mind in order to believe I'm omniscient or I am maximally reliable or whatever. So epistemic circularity actually even infects God. I don't think the fact that God has an infinite number of beliefs can help with this, because God is still using God's own mind to think through these beliefs, right? So God uses epistemically circular processes, right? But two, we have to start somewhere. We have to trust our brains when we evaluate even transcendental arguments. You know, we have to start with our own reasoning process. If God comes down and tells us this thing is true, we still have to trust that we're perceiving God correctly, that we're hearing the things that God is telling us correctly. We can't get out of our own heads. So I just think there's no way to get out of this, no matter what epistemological method you're using. So I think, yeah, there is some circularity involved. We can talk about why logical circularity and malignant circularity aren't good and aren't trustworthy. But at the same time, everyone, even presuppositionalists themselves, are going to have to reason with some epistemic circularity.
Yeah, so, I mean, it sounds like you'd say that, you know, the presuppositional approach, because this is a common objection, that it uses circular reasoning, so that we shouldn't listen to it, or we shouldn't, you know, adhere to this method. But it sounds like you're saying that we all have to use some type of circular reasoning, and that's not a bad reason to use the method.
It's not always a bad reason. So an argument that is blatantly question begging, the one that I said, like, God exists, God wrote the Bible, so yeah, the Bible's valid, so God exists, mm-hmm, or whatever, you know, I mean, that's logical circularity. And that's not a good argument, at least in the sense that it's not convincing. The premises don't give you additional reason to believe the conclusion. However, yeah, I do think we all have to engage in some level of circularity where we rely on some process to establish that process's reliability, for example. I also think too, I mean, yeah, it's like our precepts. So a common objection to presuppositionalism is that their argument is circular because they're like using the Bible to justify the Bible or something. Is that the thought?
Yeah, so I guess it would be good to recap the specific version of the transcendental argument for God that a lot of presuppositionalists use would go something like this. God is the precondition for the use of logic and morality. Everyone uses logic and morality, therefore everyone presupposes God when using logic and morality. Where the circular claim comes in is typically premise one, where it seems to many that God is being assumed without giving any evidence for it. And then, of course, it concludes with all humans believing in God, therefore appearing to be circular reasoning.
I don't think that transcendental arguments have to be circular. A is a precondition for the possibility of B. B, therefore A, you know? I don't see why that in and of itself is circular in a problematic way. It's not question begging. It doesn't have the features of malignant circularity that Bergman talks about. So I don't see a problem with transcendental arguments in general.
Well, good job. You know, you got brownie points from the precepts.